is December 2009, and we're talking with Larry Walker, one of the Museum of Contemporary Art of Georgia's Working Artist Project winners for 2007-2008. He had his major exhibition in 2008. Hello, Larry.
Hey.
Glad you're here today. We want to create this oral history of your life and your work for the Education Resource Center as part of the Working Artist Project Award.
Well, in that case, you probably want to know a little bit about how I came about, how I came to be an artist, mm-hmm. where I came from, and all those kinds of good things, right?
Exactly. So we're just turning the camera on you, and just tell us.
Okay.
And if I interject a question, that would be fine too. But we'll just listen to you.
Well, I'm the youngest of 11, born to my mom and dad in rural Georgia. Rural Georgia meaning Franklin County. Out in the area where it was primarily farmland. And my understanding is that at one point we owned about 100 acres of land. It disappeared somewhere along the way in the during the Depression. But being the youngest of 11, there was such space between my oldest brother and myself. He was actually old enough to be my dad. And my father died when I was 6 months old, so I never even knew him. My mother never remarried. She raised the kids on her own. As each kid got a little older, they helped out with the family and so forth. And somewhere around the age of 3, I think it was, the house burned down. At that point in time, we were sharecropping because those 100 acres of land had disappeared somewhere along the way. We were down to sharecropping and picking cotton and selling stuff and all that. But the house caught on fire and burned down. And then we had nothing left, so the family started breaking up. The older ones moved away, and we moved in with my oldest brother in LaGrange. And that was an interesting experience. We were there for a little bit, and then we found a place of our own in LaGrange. We moved there, and I started school there with kindergarten. And the only thing I remember about kindergarten was I encountered a snake on the way to school one day. It scared me to death. I enjoyed the little sand pit they had at school where you could push little cars and things around in the sand. That was kind of exciting and fun. That's about all I remember from school at that point in time. And somewhere along the way, we had a dog. It's the only pet that I remember. His name was Jack, German Shepherd. Anyway, when I was about 6 years old, the family moved away to New York. And this was a matter of my mom and the youngest of the kids moving to New York to live with an older sister who had just recently got married and had another sister in New York at that time who was living close by. So we moved to New York, and that was a very strange experience for me in terms of getting on a train for the first time, riding a train that distance for the first time. I had never liked riding on a train since then. It was demeaning from my perspective. We had to pack up all of the stuff. You know, we had lunches and food and fried chicken and this and that, all in baskets. And we're sitting on a train, and I could still smell the odor of fried chicken. The thing that was annoying and exasperating was that we seemed to be spectacles. Everybody was looking at us. You know? I didn't like that notion. Why are you looking at us? What do? We didn't do anything. We were just sitting here and having to eat and so forth. When we got to New York, we went from the train to the subway, and from the subway, we eventually got to the stop where we were supposed to be, and we came out of the subway. It was the first time that I saw that I was in another place. Because otherwise, it had been Georgia, then a train, then another train, and now I'm walking down the street and the buildings were soaring. They were going up to the heavens, and I just couldn't imagine how buildings could be that tall. It was just miraculous. I said, my goodness, it's like moving to another world. And at the time, I realized that I was walking down 145th Street in Harlem, and the buildings were six-story tenement houses. But it was a magnificent experience at that point in time. So going to school in New York was cool. Went to PS 90. The teachers there discovered that I could do a little drawing, so they had me working on maps and doing panoramic scenes for various things. And that was all very enjoyable. But during that period of time in New York, it was also a pressing time for gangs. There were gangs in almost every block in Harlem. The street we lived on, 145th Street, did not have a gang. One, because every 10 blocks in Harlem at that point in time was a major street. It had businesses on either one or both sides of the street. And it cut down the number of apartment buildings. So the reduction in the number of apartment buildings reduced the number of kids in that block, which reduced the need for a gang in that block. So some of the kids in the block belong to gangs on the street next door. But anyway, the other thing that was intriguing about that was that when you got to junior high school, at that point in time, all the boys in a given area, all the boys in a given area went to one junior high school. And all the girls in that same area went to another junior high school. So we had this separation of boys and girls at the junior high school level. But that exacerbated the situation of bringing gangs together. So, wow, we had this fantastic situation where the opportunity of major battles going on was always there. And one thing that was helpful to me was that Stanley, who was the leader of the gang on 143rd Street, discovered that I could draw. So he had me drawing pictures of women, girls, and so forth, things that I really didn't know much about, but I'd seen some little books and things around the way. So I had to do these drawings for him, and he protected me. He wouldn't let anybody bother me for 2 years. The standing was pretty cool in that regard. So, let's see. The junior high school teacher was a major influence in my life at that point in time. Her name was Miss Evans, a short little lady. She ruled the art room with an iron hand. Nobody messed with her. Didn't matter how big you were, how bad you were, nobody you mess with Miss Evans. You'd have to come up to the front of the room and stick your hand up and get wet with a ruler. So one day Stanley did something that was shouldn't have done. So the teacher had him come up to the front of the room. Oh, Miss Evans, I don't know, Miss Evans, you don't know. So he goes up and says, put the hand out, Stanley, you know the rules. Sticks his hand out, gets the whack. Somebody in the back started to giggle. And Stanley was all over him. You suck, Troy, Troy, so and so, you good. You know. But Stanley was an interesting guy. He, at the end of the, toward the end of the term, he decided he and his warlord is the second in command of the gang. I don't remember his name. He had one tooth in front of his face. He and his warlord decided that everybody in the class was going to contribute to a gift from Miss Evans. So if everybody came with little bits and pieces of money, you know, they didn't know whether or not this was going to Stanley's pocket or what. But at the end of the term, Stanley walks up to the last day of class. He walks up to the teacher and says, Miss Evans, we have something for you. And he had a Degas print that he had gone out and bought from someplace with the money that everybody had contributed. I was so impressed with the fact that this tough guy, this leader of a gang, had mobilized enough energy and effort and had enough sensitivity to pull this thing off and present it. And I never knew what happened to Stanley, but what always impressed me was that what a person seems to be doesn't always identify who they really are. Mm-hmm. Well, a person can be two or three different kinds of things, or kinds of, have different attitudes. So that impression of, that he helped create was something that carried through with me down the road. And anyway, Ms. Evans identified about four students from her class, and she sent us off to take the entrance exam at the high school music and art. High school music and art is up on the hill. It's kind of, it was like the elite school for people who wanted to participate in the arts. The sister school is High School of Performing Arts, which is also in New York. And that school focused on dance, theater, and popular music. The High School of Music and Art focused on the visual arts and classical music. So all the students at the school had an interest in one or more of the arts. Mm-hmm. They had to do the academic program as well. So going there at the end of the eighth grade allowed you to have a four-year high school experience, which then could incorporate the art programs as well as the academic programs. So we all went up to the High School Music and Art knowing that we were going to get beat up because we were going out of our little element. Mm-hmm. You know, all these kids are coming from different places and it's just going to be strange. And we got there and it's all terrified. It all turned out to be wonderful. Nobody got beat up. Nobody got attacked for any reason at all. Sometime later, I came to the realization that all the students from various parts of the city, Queens, the Bronx, Brooklyn, and so forth, they all had the same attitude that they were going to get beat up. They knew that going out of that element was mm-hmm. just going to get wiped out at the school. And none of that happened. It was the first time in my life that I had come to school with anyone who was not, you know, someone who, other than blacks. Mm-hmm. It was the first time in my life that I had experienced that kind of diversity. In fact, a young man, one of my classmates, came to school one day with a hamster on his shoulder. And I looked at it and thought it was a rat. I had no idea that hamsters were little pets and things. So he assured me that it was safe and so on. But there were kids there who were from Lithuania, kids that I'd never heard of Lithuania, and kids there from Germany and from various other schools and various other countries. So the diversity aspect was something that was impressive. So you combine this notion that people from different backgrounds can get along and share the same environment, along with the attitude that someone who's tough and mean can have a soft, sensitive inner. Mm-hmm. Those two factors somehow become part of my work later on. Going through the High School Music and Art was a wonderful experience. One of the teachers, there were a number of teachers influenced me during that time, but one of the teachers particularly was Miss Lee Rosen. Lee Rosen, she taught ceramics and she taught design. And I had her for both, but the design class particularly was a class unlike any other design class I ever had. We walked in the first day and she said something to the effect that, "Don't plan on making cute little things to take home to share with your parents because it's not going to happen. In fact, you may not have anything left to take home to share with your parents when you finish with this class. And what you need to know is, what you need for this class is a pair of scissors, a box of straight pins, a pack of black construction paper, and a piece of cardboard, such and such size." So we got all the materials and we came to class. And each day we in class, we would cut little strips of black paper, sometimes half inch, quarter inch, or less. It had various sizes, different lengths, and so forth. And she would give us a problem. And the problem would be something like this. Create a sense of harmony on this cardboard. So we'd take our little black strips of paper and manipulate them around until we got what we thought was a harmonious relationship between these strips. Then we pin them down, put them up on the wall, have a critique, take it apart, come up with another problem. Now, create oppositional conflict. But every day there was a new term that we had to use and take these little pieces of paper and manipulate them around until they filled that space and they became what she had wanted us to articulate. Mm-hmm. that was a fascinating kind of class. And anyway, we get to the high school experience, and by the time I finished high school, I was focused then. I was going to be an artist. There was no doubt about it. I didn't know what that meant, but that's what I was going to be. But I didn't know what I was going to do after school. So people would ask me, what are you going to do when you graduate? What are you going to do? I'm going to so and so. I'm going to such a school. And so forth. And I had no idea. By this time, my family situation was such that myself and two sisters were the only ones left in the apartment in New York. My mother, who had gotten ill, had moved to Detroit to live with my oldest brother because he was in a better position to take care of her than us three kids who were all in school. I was in high school. My next sister in line was at the Fashion Institute of Technology, and the older sister beyond that was finishing up at Hunter College. Incidentally, out of all these 11 kids, my mother's goal was to make sure they got an education. She was concerned that education was absolutely critical for these kids to have, and her sights were set on high school. She made sure that every one of those kids got a high school education. Many of them went on and got college educations beyond that, but everyone got the high school education. And she did this struggling, working on her own, working in hotels as a maid, washing things and taking care of other people's clothing and houses and so forth. But she always carried herself with a kind of sense of dignity that I thought was, kind of strange given the fact that we were in this poor environment. Of course, when we first got to New York, the notion of being poor wasn't a major issue because everybody around us was in the same boat, so nobody really thought of themselves as poor. It was just, that's the way it was. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't until I got to be older and in high school and branching out and meeting people who were from different backgrounds and different locations and lived in different parts of the city that I started to realize that, hey, where I was living was really, really a depressed area, okay? And although there were areas that were more depressed, and I know that then, I knew that then, and I know it now. But we come back up to the point where I'm now graduating from high school and having to make a decision what I was going to do. So the choices were, go to Detroit, because that's what my mother and my brother wanted me to do, come and live in Detroit, go to college there. Or to enroll in a place like Cooper Union in New York, which was a thought. Or join the Army. Or, the fourth one, continue working in the supermarket where I had been working. So I kicked all those things around, and finally at the last minute decided, I'll just go to Detroit, I'll go to Wayne State University, because that's the thing. So I moved at 17. I graduated from high school. I went to New York. Went from New York to Detroit. And lived with my brother. Had a little room up there upstairs. It was the first time I had a little room that was all mine. It was kind of cute, cool. Put up my little drawings and paintings and stuff. And helped take care of my mom. Then I went down the street one day into the A&P supermarket and said, I'd like to get a job. And the manager looked at me and said, what makes you think you can work in a supermarket? I said, I got 4 years experience. He says, what do you mean you got 4 years experience? How old are you? 17. You got 4 years experience working in markets? I said, yeah. He says, okay, I'm going to hire you to be a bagger. Let's see how you do. So bagging groceries was no big thing. I could time it. I could work out a way in which I could work on 3 or 4 registers at the same time. Go from this one, bag this groceries up, and then go over and do the next one while that cashier is ringing that person up, and then go to the next one and so forth. And putting things in the bag was a fascinating thing for me. It got more fascinating after I finally got in school, but I'll tell you about that in a minute. But I'll have to mix them up a little bit. But the fascinating thing in terms of bagging was you had a volume of space with this bag. This volume of space was generally rectangular and deep and so forth. And all the things that you put in that bag had different shapes. Some squares, rectangles, you know, cylindrical forms, etc. How to put these things in the bag and retain the integrity of that volume so that the things didn't fall out. And then the added element was to put like things together. So to do this, I would do things like double the bag, put two bags together, you know, which created a little problem with the management because they're saying, you're wasting too many bags. You know, just use one bag, don't use two. But I gotta use two in order to make this. Just do what I said. Anyway, I was doing that, and that was working out okay. And then I would walk around. I was, you know, moving back and forth in the store. And at the back of the store, there was another area where they sold the A&P coffee, where you grind it up yourself and so on. And the dairy products were there. They had their own person back there who ran the dairy, made sure things were stocked, sold the coffee directly there. So sometimes I'd walk by there and there would be a customer waiting to get his coffee ground or paid for, and the person who was supposed to be there was somewhere else. So I'd go back in, bring up the coffee, and the manager would come by and say, what are you doing working on the cash register? You're not qualified to work on the cash register. But I've done this before, you know. Where'd you do this before? At my other job in New York. Which I did.
Yeah.
You stay off the cash register, you do this today. So finally, one day after some period of time, they decided, well, since he actually does know how to run the cash register, let's put him on the cash register. Mm-hmm. So I'm a cashier. I'm running the cash register. We created other little games. One, since I had been a bagger and I had put stock on the shelves, I knew the prices of most of the stuff. Mm-hmm. So I could just look at the can and rate it up. So you're talking about speed. That was fantastic. A good number of the people who worked at the supermarket were either high school or college students working part-time. And that particular market, the one where I worked, produced three teachers, one medical doctor, one business person, and two people who stayed with A&P and worked their way up to that. I don't know what happened to everybody else, but this was, an amazing combination of things going on at that one little store. And the camaraderie between all the people there was just fantastic, and the kinds of learning experiences were just wonderful. Mm-hmm. And I could, by this time I was in school, and I think I mentioned that I was in school, and I was taking sculpture classes, I was taking drawing classes, and I learned to relate what I was doing in school to what I was doing in the supermarket. Mm-hmm. I understood perspective by standing at the top of the, you know, at the end of an aisle in the morning after putting all the things on the shelf and watching and looking at everything moving toward one point. And I knew what one point perspective was, and I could move to the side, I could see angular perspective. And I understood it. And I understood design, because the challenge for me at one point was to go, at one point I was working at night. You go in 8:30, 9 o'clock at night, work the next morning, restocking shelves. Mm-hmm. And one of the exciting things was to go in there when almost everything was gone off the shelves. You had to rebuild the entire thing. Mm-hmm. So I would rebuild the shelf. And as long as I stayed within the format of small things at the top, and middle-sized cans in the middle, and big cans on the bottom, and kept all of the vegetables, this is the aisle that I haven't worked myself into. You had all the green beans together, all the corn together, etc. That was fine. So I would go in and I would create these patterns. Like Stokely cans were kind of a white can. The label was white predominantly. Ionic, which was an A&P brand, was kind of a black label. Del Monte was predominantly a green label. Every brand had their own kind of identity. And I would group these things together so that on one occasion I would have a green ribbon coming from the top to the bottom, next to a white ribbon, next to a black ribbon, next to something else. you know, when all, everything would be right, all the pieces would be together, corner would be together, etc. But it would be in these color patterns. And I was relating that to what I was doing in classes. And it would all be evened out so that, you know, if you had five cans on the top, that was one color. There was in the next row, it was five cans in the same color, five cans in the same color all the way down. Even if there was nothing behind it. So you had, if you had to face it off and put like 10 cans, five on top of each other to get that, that's what we would do. Yeah, it was fun. And another occasion, it might be changing everything around. So when you went in, you had a checkerboard pattern in green, red, yellow, you know, like that. But it was all organized. It made sense. The assistant manager came by one day and says, you know, when you guys face everything off and bring it up to the front, I don't know what's behind it. And it's screwing up my ordering. He said, well, we can solve that. Let us do the ordering. Because we know what's there. He thought about it and said, it's not a bad idea. So he let us do the ordering. So we did that for a while until upper management caught up with it and decided that we couldn't do the ordering because we were taking an assistant manager's job. So that was fine. The good old days in the supermarket were part of growing up. I worked in the supermarket throughout my time. Oh, I got to tell you about the Wayne State University thing. I've got to backtrack a little bit. I'm now living in Detroit. I'm, you know, living with my brother and helping take care of my mom. And I had made no preparations to go to school, so it was almost time for school to start. So I go down to Wayne State University and said, okay, here I am. And they said, who are you? And I said, I'm Larry Walker. I'm here to go to school. They said, where's your paperwork? What paperwork? I didn't know I had anything. He said, you don't have a transcript? No. Did you ask the school to send this transcript? No. I said, well, you can't just walk in here and go to school. You got to have some, you got to do some paperwork. I said, well, what can I do? He says, well, you can, at this point in time, since it's so late, you have to take an entrance exam. I said, okay, fine, give it to me. So they gave me the entrance exam, and I took the entrance exam, and I went back the next week, or whatever it was. And said, okay, here I am, I'm ready now. He says, oh, we're sorry, you can't come here. I said, why? He says, you didn't pass the entrance exam. I said, what? I told all my friends in New York I was going to go to Wayne State University. Then they told me I can't go. He says, yeah, well, you know, you didn't pass the entrance exam, you didn't do any other preparation to get here. I said, what can I do? He says, well, you can do one of several things. You can come back and take the entrance exam at another time. Or you can go to community college, and if you get a B average, you can transfer here, you know, in the next semester or next year. And I said, okay, where's the closest junior college? And they told me. I said, okay, I'm going to go there. So I went up there, I walked in, it was a Highland Park Community College, and I ran into another influential art person, Sarah Miles. Sarah Miles was the counselor and art teacher. She taught everything. She was a painter. She taught painting, drawing, art history, everything. And she was sitting there talking, and she explained to me what I needed to take. She said, you take this drawing class, you take this English class, you take this painting class, and you take this art history class, and you take this. I said, wait a minute. Take art history? You want me to take an art history class? She says, yes, it's no problem. Everybody takes an art history class. I said, I don't need that. She says, what do you mean you don't need this? I said, I had that. So where did you have this art history class? I said, I had it in high school. You're telling me that you had a high school art history class that's equivalent to this college level art history class? I said, yeah. She says, no, it's not. So we go back and forth. And finally, she says, okay, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to give you the final exam. If you pass it, I'll waive this class. If you don't pass it, you take it. I said, fine, when do you want me to come back and do it? She said, right now. Put up or shut up. I said, don't, well, it's been a while, but I need a refresher when I get this. No, put up or shut up, she said. And she gave me the final exam, and I took it, and we were both surprised. One, I did pass it. Two, I didn't pass it with the highest grade. And there was a whole section on the exam that I knew nothing about, Melanesian art. And she discovered that. She says, the probability is your class didn't not do Melanesian art. I said, no, never heard of it. She said, well, there are some things that you can't learn in this class. And I was more humble at that point because I didn't do as well as I thought I was going to do. And she was very surprised because I actually passed it. Mm-hmm. So she convinced me that I could gain more from doing this and I could contribute at the same time and so on and so on. I was sold. Then she recognized, apparently, that she had about three or four people in the class, three particular, myself, Bart Robert Weil, and Richard Iskanian, who seemed to have a little bit more experiences than some of the other students. So she cleared out a storeroom and created a studio for the three of us to go to the studio whenever we weren't in class, some class, and we could work there and so forth. I was so impressed with the fact that she had that kind of faith in us. She believed in us that much that I was sold. And at the end of that first year, all three of us wound up going to Wayne State University, transferred there. Richard Kane eventually became a high school art teacher who was kind of an elite person in the Detroit area. Robert Mahali eventually, he taught in the school system too, but he eventually became a professor at Michigan State. And I eventually taught in the Sherbrooke school system, but initially, another unique experience was one day when I was about 20, I guess. I remember asking myself, okay, now that you know a little bit about this and a little bit about that, what are you going to do when you graduate? I knew that I wanted to do something with people, and I knew that I wanted to do something with my work that was all mine and not for somebody else. So I went through everything that I knew about using those two things as criteria, okay? And I immediately eliminated anything that was commercial art related. Graphic design was gone, interior design was gone, you know, illustration was gone, and art history was gone for another reason. But several things disappeared, and the only thing left by the time I finished with this was teaching. And the more I thought about teaching, the more it made sense. It would allow me to work with people. It would allow me to do what I wanted to do with my work without interference. If I'd gone into graphic design, it was for architecture or some of the other commercially oriented areas, I would have to be concerned about the client. Mm-hmm. Nothing wrong with being concerned about the client, but it was not what I wanted to do. And it's an important part of that particular field to work toward the client's goals and to modify and mellow and meld things together in such a way. That's important, but I was not particularly interested in doing that. So the more I thought about teaching, the more it made sense to me. So I went to the department chair and I said, I want to change my major from fine arts to art education. Hmm. He spent about a half hour trying to talk me out of it. And I said, what's the problem? And he finally decided, okay, I'm going to sign the papers for you, but I'm going to give you some advice. And the advice was, whatever you do, don't let them fill you with too much methodology. And I said, oh no, not a problem. I said, I have the summers to do what I want to do, and you know, I got the weekends to do what I want to do. I clearly didn't know what methodology meant, and he knew that I didn't know what methodology meant. Mm-hmm. But I went into art education, and I did the student teaching thing, and it was just big revelation, a new awakening, different things to do, different approaches, things to learn, and so forth. And I did finish it. I wound up teaching. I had a job before I graduated in the Detroit Public School System, teaching at Pat Gill Elementary School. I was one of two art teachers. I had all of the fifth and sixth graders. The other art teacher had all of the third and fourth graders. I had an art room. I had something like 14 different classes with about 38 students per class, give or take. And class classes were like, if I remember correctly, 35 minutes. But you could sometimes double them, so you had two periods together. And most of what I, a lot of what I learned from one of the student teaching experiences that was my weakest. It was my weakest because the master teacher and I did not get along. He had notions about what should be done, and I had notions about what should be done. And they just didn't match up. But I learned a lot from him. And when I got to my own teaching situation, I wound up using a lot of those things. And it was kind of autocratic. It was like, okay, in order to maximize the amount of time the students have to work, I have to minimize the amount of time that they have doing other stuff, like passing out materials, collecting materials. So that's nothing to do with creativity, except I gotta be creative with how to do it. So I came up with these notions about how to get these things done. I spent about a week organizing this. So every class had to have a class chairman, an assistant. Every class had a table captain. Every class had a materials captain for paint, for paper, for crayons, or whatever the materials were. But there was about five of those. And then after they had all of that, the people who were going to be the class chairman and assistant class chairman had to get elected. Everybody else, I said, no, I'm sorry, everybody got elected except the table captains. The table captains, I selected. Whoever won, whoever was sitting in the first seat became the table captain. And their job was to know who was at the table so that when attendance was taken, they could tell you. And their job was to receive all of the materials that were being distributed, and they distributed at their own table. But everybody else had to be elected. And in order to be elected, they had, people had to know who they were. So we had these elections that went on where people had to stand up and say who they were and so forth. And they were learning democracy. But through this whole experience, you know, after we got everybody elected to positions, then we had practice sessions. So, okay, now, the paper captain has to be able to pass out paper to every, to these, all the people in the room in 15 seconds or 20 seconds. I made up the time. I don't know how long it took to do this stuff, but I didn't make up these times. But you can't run. And everybody has to go the same direction. You start with table one, you go to table two, and then table three, table four. You give the material to the table captain, and you leave. Do not walk around and give stuff to each person. The table captain takes one, passes the rest around. Mm-hmm. At the end of the day, everything gets passed back to the table captain. It's in one spot. Then people go to collect things. So I would tie these people. Okay. Paper captain would start, followed by the paint captain, followed by the whatever captain, you know, scissors or whatever we're using for the day. Nobody ran into each other because they were all going the same way. They all started in the same direction. Nobody ran, okay? And I reserved the right to fire anybody who couldn't get the job done. I don't know if I ever fired anybody or not. It was wonderful fun, and it was good experience, and it maximized the amount of time that the students had to work. Mm-hmm. It was good. And then I went from there to high school, and from high school, and somewhere along the way, I went back to Wayne State University to get a master's. I figured, okay, since they told me I couldn't go to this school, I get my undergraduate here and get my master's here too. Mm-hmm. And one of the reasons for going to get my master's was if I was going to stay in teaching, I needed to have a second, what they call it, a permanent certificate. I had a provisional certificate. I needed a permanent certificate. In order to get the permanent certificate, I had to take some additional classes or get another degree. So I figured if I'm going to do that, I may as well get another degree. And if I was going to get another degree, the question was, what was that degree going to be? And the thing about methodology focused came back into focus. By then, I understood what it meant. Mm-hmm. And understood it to such an extent that I knew that art education was not what I wanted to do for a master's. I wanted to get back into fine arts, so I said, develop my own work. So I did that. And the closer I got to finishing that master's degree, the further removed I felt from the elementary kids. So I applied for high school, and I started sending out letters for colleges. Now, there's a couple things that I've omitted in here that were very important to me in terms of shaping my life. I'm going to backtrack a little bit if you can kind of move back in time to the year that I'm graduating with my undergraduate degree. Just before I graduated, I also got married. Okay? And in the early days of that marriage, I was working part-time, going to school full-time, and my wife, Gwen, was working full-time and going to school part-time. And we managed to keep things going, and we eventually had our oldest daughter, Dana, and then our son, Larry, and went through, the good old things in Detroit, playing in the snow and all those kinds of wonderful things, shoveling snow, carrying kids around. And when I went back to school, I also went back to work at the supermarket. So I was working full-time at the school, going to school, working on a master's. I was a husband and a father of two. And I was working part-time at A&P Supermarket. And I still had time to paint. Mostly at night. But the whole business of melding together a sense of life and activities and responsibilities, it all seemed to make sense at that time. And I didn't think about it as being an awkward or a burden or something like that. I'm sure that in some ways I probably sacrificed some time that I could have used in some other ways, but at the same time, it seemed to get things done. And as I was finishing the master's, as I said, I was starting to feel further and further removed from the elementary kids. So I applied for high school, got that. At the same time, I was applying for colleges. And then all of a sudden, a little college popped up and said, hey, why don't you come out here and let us interview you. And this was a school in California. This was the University of the Pacific. And they apparently got interested because, one, I had a master's in fine arts, but at the same time, I had 6 years teaching experience in the school system, and they wanted somebody who could teach drawing, painting, and art education. And the art education part was for the students in their program who were planning to teach in the school system, but who were also, just going to be regular home teachers who also had the art background. So, going to California for an interview, wow. And the deal was, if you come out here for an interview and we don't offer you the job, we pay for the interview anyway, the transportation and accommodations and all that. If we offer you the job and you accept it, you still pay for all of those things. But if we offer you the job and you turn it down, you have to pay half of it. I said, whoa, okay. So I told my wife, if they offer the job and it's anywhere close to what I'm making now, I'm taking it. Even though it was a job that was a 1 year replacement for somebody who was on leave, possibly 2 years, if she decided to exercise that option. So they offered the job. They were within a couple $100 of what I was making. So California, here we come. We pack up and move to California. And friends and relatives were saying things like, what is wrong with you? You're going to go to California, all the way out there. You don't know anybody out there. You've never been there before. This is not a great idea. This is maybe 1 year or 2 years, and then what happens if it doesn't work out? Well, so I said to my wife, what happens if this doesn't work out? She says, no, we'll do something else. Okay, fine. So we drive to California. Great experience. As it turned out, I was at the University of Pacific for 19 years. The first year went by and things went relatively well. The second year went relatively well. And the third year, the person who was on leave asked for a third year, unprecedented leave. And the administration came and asked me if I would stay for a third year. And I said, well, you know, the circumstances have changed a little bit. You really should, you know, think of some other scenario. And they went to the drawing boards and they came back and decided they would keep me if she came back, well, if she came back or not. She did eventually come back for about a year and then she went on to do some other things. But the experience at University of Pacific was a very unique and wonderful learning experience. I remember at one occasion, I was just doing the things that I thought were right, things that I knew that kids needed. In terms of teaching art education classes, I did some reading, I did some research to supplement the experience aspects. And I was teaching life drawing, I was teaching drawing and painting, and so forth. And one of the things that was current at that time in teaching the life drawing class was that at that particular school, they never used undraped models. They always had something on. There seemed to be the trend at some small schools. They had bathing suits or leotards or something like that. And I said, why can't we just do undraped models? And the department chair says, well, you know, we're a private liberal arts school. Maybe we don't need that. And I finally convinced him that we did. And he in turn had to go and talk to the dean. And the dean initially turned it down. So, one year we got a different dean, a new person came in. So I raised the issue again. So he raised it with that new dean. And I had to go talk to him. I explained to him why we needed to do this, and how other schools are doing this, and that this is not, and this has nothing to do with sexual involvement and so forth. This is a necessary thing. So he okayed it. So we started that. And it worked out very well. And it's still going. And we did a lot of things. We somewhere along the way, the person who was the department chair, who was instrumental in hiring me, decided he was going to give up to being the chair. And he nominated me for the position, which was an interesting experience in view of the fact that I was the youngest of the two other people who were there, or four of us all together. But I accepted that position, and I chaired the department for 3 years, for 7 years. It was during the sixth year, the college decided they would do a rotation thing on the chairs. And it would be a 3-year term followed by a possible second 3-year term, but a 6-year max. I said, well, I'm in my 6th year already. So they said, well, we won't count that. So you'll have to go another year. It's fine. And I went to 7th year, and that was fine because I had met a lot of people around the country. I had done a lot of things. After I left the position, I was working on a grant for the California Arts Council, from the California Arts Council. And that was exciting and fun and all that. But it involved writing and doing research for San Joaquin County, trying to figure out how to maximize the art involvement of these various communities throughout the county. And my partner and I, Shisada Watanabe, he did that painting over there and said, one of the hair things hanging on it. We went to various communities and we talked to them, we got information from them, we did surveys, we did all kinds of stuff, and compiled this report that was, we got it all together, we had so much information, we had to figure out how to how to bring it together. So we went to a mathematician who used statistics and how to do all that stuff to get some help as how to structure this thing. She was so impressed with what we had. She says, this is equivalent to a PhD. I said, oh, that's cool. That's my PhD then, because that's I'm not going to go get one. Anyway, after having done that, and after having been, while I was department chair, having been involved in the National Council of Bar Administrators, and not having been out of the position for a few years, I came to realize that I missed the administration, which is unheard of. Nobody misses administration. When you do it, you get out of it. It's going as soon as you can. But I missed it. I missed the camaraderie. I missed the business of making decisions and being in a position to have people listen to what you wanted, what you had to say, and so forth. So I decided I needed to go back into administration. So I started applying around. And Georgia State University here in Atlanta invited me out for an interview. So I came up with an interview and just had a ball, answered questions and talked to all these various people and so forth. And then I went home. And I figured, well, I guess that was the end of that because I haven't heard anything in the last month or so. So learning about in the second month, I think it was, I got a phone call from the dean who wanted me to come back for another interview. And this time bring my wife. I said, oh, wait a minute, what's wrong with you bringing my wife? You're going to hire my wife, you're going to hire me. If he's going to hire me, oh, what's he going on? So we came out for the interview. And this interview was much better. Because the first thing was, they had to stay in a better hotel than the first time. The first time was a dinky little place. It was all right, but it was nothing like staying at the Peachtree Plaza Hotel with the 70-story cylindrical building and all that. I'm getting signals. And the signals are saying something like...
Right, I have 10 minutes left.
You have 10 minutes left?
Yeah, I can...
My goodness, I'll just keep talking.
I can get an extra tape if there's a CVS over here. I'm going to do that. I just have to go and finish.
Okay. So they asked me to come on to Georgia State University and head up the program. And I thought that was intriguing because second time I'd become a department chair and I was replacing someone who'd been in the position for 25 years. Vice in a row, my goodness. That was interesting. And anyway, joining the faculty at Georgia State University was intriguing, and I knew coming in that I was probably not going to be able to do as much artwork as I had been doing in the past, at least for a year or so, because I needed to get organized, get structured, get familiar with what needed to happen and what needed to be done and so forth. And that was true. And for about a year and a half, I just did piddly little things. And eventually got back into the swing of working. And by then I could coordinate my time a little better, could reduce the number of days that I had to be on campus from 5 or 6 sometimes, down to 4, 4.5, and then work on the weekends. But over the years, I've always managed to be able to get something done in the studio and always frequently participated in juried exhibitions and curated exhibitions and occasionally a solo exhibit. But for a long time, I didn't have a gallery. And it seems as though for some period of time, every time I connected with a gallery, some strange thing happened. Like one gallery, Eve Manis Gallery here in Berlin. Shortly after I got with her, she decided to give up the gallery and go off to do some private things. So that was intriguing. And I had another thing with the gallery that Camille Love had. Mm-hmm. Connected up with her shortly after she got a position as director of the Bureau of Cultural Affairs and gave up her gallery. Mm-hmm. Had a gallery up in Chicago back in the 90s. And shortly after connecting with her, she decided to give up the gallery and go work for George Nandi. That was not intriguing. Mm-hmm. So, and in each case, I think the gallery had managed to like maybe sell one or two pieces of mine, and then that was the end of it. Mm-hmm. And I had other strange situations. I had a gallery out in New Mexico, the Welland Gallery, and the owner passed away suddenly. And the new people came, and they had a different notion of how the gallery should operate. They went another direction. Anyway, so for a while I stayed away from galleries, and then eventually settled into a few. Right now, with Sandy Webster Gallery in Philadelphia, Mason Muir Gallery here in Atlanta, Delma Harris Gallery in Oakland, California. And I've been, I had a kind of a dialogue going with the Lusinoff Gallery up in Chicago, but he's now decided to give up the gallery too, so that's another one. And there's a small gallery in Detroit that I've been talking with, but I don't know if that's going to happen or not. At any rate, at this point in my life, it's nice to have gallery exhibitions, but I'm more focused on things that would be a little bit more long-term, such as having work in museums and major collections. That's my primary interest right now. Hoping that something will be left for somebody to look at and think about and relate to down the road. And I think on another day, I'll probably have to tell you a little bit more about the work itself, because I like the work. I'm pleased with what I've been.
Okay.
Yeah, I think at this point in my life, getting up in age and so forth, I'm very much interested in having the work be around for somebody to learn something from or to examine for one reason or another. So it's important for me that the work be available in major collections and in museum collections and so forth. But I'm impressed with some of what I'm doing. I'm not bragging or anything. I just think that where I've come from has been a long journey, and it's now all starting to come together in a kind of interesting way. And I'll try to talk about some of those connections and so forth, and maybe back up to the time when I mentioned something about Stanley being an influence, and I mentioned something about my high school experience being an influence and so forth. And I think some of those things are interwoven into some of the work. Mm-hmm. But also interwoven into the work in a lot of ways, very quiet ways, in my family. My family has been supportive throughout the entire time that I've been working on art and working as a teacher. Before I got married, my family was supportive. Although, as I said earlier, my mom was always interested in us getting an education, but she never tried to dictate or suggest in any strong way that we ought to go into this field or that field. It was get the education, do the best you can, and go from there. So throughout the family, we had people who were teachers, some who were, there's just one artist. Me, I guess. One sister did fashion design for a while, but she gravitated into broadcasting. Had a science teacher, and a career service person. We had a career post office person, and things like that. At any rate, they all did pretty well. Right now, we're at a point in our family history where there's only myself and two sisters left, and it's kind of sobering in one sense, but it's important to remember some of the things that you learn from each of those family members. But in terms of my immediate family, that's been a marvelous experience. I've indicated that my oldest daughter Dana and my son Larry were both born in Detroit and moved to California. They were five and four, I guess, when we moved to California and went to schools there. And they both have now, everybody's grown, but in the meantime, Kara, the youngest one, was born 10 years after the oldest one. So that was a unique experience too, because it gave them, gave the two oldest kids an opportunity to see what it was like growing up with the younger sister. And it gave her an opportunity to have some role models to live up to and work toward. And she could keep us all amused when she was a kid. But early on, it became evident that she was interested in art. But we were all interested in art. The older students were interested in art. They all had similar kind of experiences, because they tagged around with me going to art exhibits, carrying work from one kind of space to another space, helping pack up things. It was unique. I remember when Dana and Larry were young, I took them to see a Jean Dubuffet exhibition. And we were walking around looking at the works, and they were absorbed by all these characters that they saw in the work, and we would point out things like the texture and the color and so forth. And similarly, when Kara was young, she would go to exhibitions and she would walk around and we would talk about the same kinds of things, texture and color and so forth. And then Kara and I, Kara was born in California, and we lived just within walking distance of a farm area where there were a few cows out there in the pasture. So Kara and I would go for a little walk to see the cows. And we'd go and say hi to the cows and talk to them and so forth. And she was about 2 years old thereabouts. And it was interesting to have her saying, "Hi, Mr. Cow." but everything became an important part of her life in terms of coming to understand, coming to look at, think about, experience these things. She did drawings on the sidewalk, and those were fascinating. She would come to the studio when I was working, and she would want to paint or draw, and just provide the materials and stand back and let her do it. In fact, it was so fascinating watching her that I didn't get much done myself. But it was always fascinating watching all of the kids work, because all of the kids talked when they did the artwork. I remember my son doing it when he was young. He did a painting of a train, and he talked his way through it. He says, "This is a choo-choo train, and it goes around this way, and it goes choo-choo-choo-choo-choo-choo-choo." And he talked through the entire thing, you know. And I remember Kara doing similar things. And we tried to save some of these pieces that the kids did. And those were important things. And some of this rubbed off on my wife too, because when we got married, my wife was focused mostly on business and secretarial related activities and so on, and jobs. And she ultimately went back to school after the kids got to a certain age. And she got interested in, she took her interest in sewing and moved it into batik, sort of making batik materials and using the materials to make clothing items for all of us, in fact. And then eventually, batiks, they're not clothing items. And in recent times, all of that interest has been refunneled into digital photography and computer imagery, and being able to take some of those images and transfer them onto material for pillows and other kind of items, like handbags and so forth. So it's kind of craft-oriented, but at the same time, the interest in being creative and moving things around is sort of rubbed off on her. And she's learned a whole lot about our history just by reading and looking at what we do. And the oldest daughter has gotten, after she graduated from USC and worked in retail management for a while, she eventually went back and worked on another degree in photography and Arsenal College of Design, and she freelanced for a while, and now she's director of Art Center at Night at Arsenal College of Design. Mm-hmm. my son Larry gravitated toward music and then eventually gravitated from music into accounting because there's a relationship between numbers and music and so forth. But anyway, he's now has his own little company. He's does tax accounting and doing well with that. It's kind of consumes all his time though. And our youngest daughter, Dana Kara, is she's now teaching at Columbia University. She has the graduate program and one undergraduate class. And she manages to do all of this stuff with all the teaching, as well as keep up with her professional work, because she's, at this point, has kind of an international reputation in the arts as a painter. But now, having said all those things, let me get back to my stuff and tell you a little bit about that, because in the early days, my work went from a kind of from abstraction, I guess. And I had an interest in a lot of different artists over the years and learned a lot from different people. I learned a lot from Rembrandt, for example, in terms of chiaroscuro and how things move from dark to light. And I learned a great deal from Rauschenberg in terms of putting different materials together. I learned some things from Joseph Cornell, his little boxes and things that were all kind of organized and grouped, and it was fascinating stuff. Charles White, noted African-American artist, gained a lot from him just listening to him talk about his work and talk about art in general. Mm-hmm. And Raymond Saunders. In fact, at some point in time, I didn't know who Raymond Saunders was. I was exhibiting at a little place in California, in Oakland, called the Rainbow Side Gallery. And the person who was running the gallery, eventually Montgomery, E.J. Montgomery, as she was called, said something one day. She said, "I would love to do an exhibition of your work and Raymond Saunders' work together." And I said, "Who's Raymond Saunders?" "You don't know who Raymond Saunders is?" So he went on and on about that. And I finally discovered who Raymond Saunders was. I eventually met him and saw some of his work and discovered that there was a kinship between what he was doing and some of what I was doing. All this is very different, but there were some interesting relationships. It had to do with the kind of urban environment, the kind of opportunity of using some materials that were picked up in an environment and reapplied into the surface of the painting. And for some period of time, I was doing a series. Well, let me back up. I'll tell you what preceded that series. After I moved to California, I got impressed with the landscape, and I started drawing landscapes. Seeing so much sky was not something I had experienced a lot in Michigan. And the fields and so forth, and the striated lines that happen when you kind of hover above the field and look out over it and so forth. So I was doing all those things, but at the same time, I was fascinated by the fact that when you could drive down the street and you look in your rear view mirror and you see what's behind you that you've already passed. So I started a series of paintings called microscapes, and they were based on a circular format like the side view mirror, which captured this land mass in the middle of it, you know. Mm-hmm. But the thing that was intriguing for me was the fact that the circle did not contain everything. Some of the striations in the land or the movement in the land itself extended beyond the circle. So you had an environment beyond the circle and an environment inside the circle that reconnected with each other. So this duality of space became an important element. And all of that I discovered went back to this time when I was working on my master's and doing my thesis. And I set out at the beginning of that thesis to try to resolve why I had a certain approach in painting, a certain approach in drawing, and a certain approach in sculpture, and they seemed to be at odds with each other. Not at odds, but at least different. So that was my goal, to try to meld them together in some way that it came out to be one person. Mm-hmm. So my notion at the time was that I needed a style. So the more I worked at pursuing that, I did come up with something, but it wasn't style. What I came up with was the fact that I rediscovered or came to understand better something about structure, and that the structure that was evident in land masses, the structure that was evident in buildings, when you strip it down to the framework, and the structure of the human body were all interrelated, and that you had to have some sort of foundation before you could build something on top of it, or that this exterior space and this interior space somehow interacted with each other to create the whole. So in those early days, I was doing these kind of muscular looking landscapes where it's almost like stripping away the skin on the arm and finding that this muscle attenuated down to nothing, and there was a tendon running through there, and there's a bone over here. And so you had this stretched out kind of thing. It was full of energy. And the scratching, the mark making, and so forth replicated the whole idea of the kind of energy that would be evident in the body, the kind of energy that would be evident in the landscape. So that's what transferred over into these microscope drawings. And then from the microscope drawings and paintings, that kind of gravitated into another thing where I started doing a series of works, drawings and paintings of people, generally single person in an environmental space, so that there was land mass, the figure was rooted to the landscape, could not escape it. There was the figure and the land were part of each other. At the same time, there was space that went way beyond that figure itself. And it had the same kind of scratchiness to it, and so forth. And that went on for a while, and somewhere along the way, I got interested in some hard-edged looking stuff. And the work started to shift a little bit. And let me go back for a minute to the circle thing, because the circle thing and the figure thing came together as one. The circle format had a competition stripe, very hard-edged stripe, running across the upper portion of it. And these masses of people were in the lower portion. I call that the Children's Society series. And it was this, the name came from a song that was popular back in the 60s, Society's Child. And in this series, the circle represented an environment, the line represented an oppressive barrier. The people beneath that barrier were involved in doing the kinds of things that they did. Sometimes they were very complacent, sometimes they were struggling to try to get out of that kind of environment. Other times they seem to be lying there dead. Other times other activities were going on, so they enjoyed the experience or whatever. But the relationship between people to this barrier was the thing. The link between the Children's Society series and the Microfilm series was the circle. Overriding that, or the umbrella to all of that, was the fact that there's two kinds of spaces involved, an interior and an exterior. You know, a positive and a negative, oppression and freedom. These opposites that somehow interrelated, interacted in such a way that they created a new thing. And I thought back to the days at the High School of Music and Art, where you had the most people from different backgrounds, different experiences that came together to create a new experience. I thought back to Stanley, who had his own interior and exterior kind of self. And the experiences that can come out of that. So, moving ahead, the notion of interiors, exteriors, positive, negatives, the influences from Rembrandt and the chiaroscuro stuff, all started to coalesce into this business of composing. I got more and more interested in composition. And the more I got interested in composition, I could relate back to those early days when I was putting things in paper bags at the supermarket. When I was organizing things on the shelf so that this design thing came about. So when I did a painting, there was something in that painting where darks and lights interrelated in such a way that they created a structure. And in that structure, there was a sense of identity, a sense of self that said, I am a painting. And once the painting reached that point, then I was satisfied. And it didn't matter to me so much whether the subject matter or the content was as evident as it had been at an earlier point in my life. Now, there was a point, earlier in my life when subject matter was kind of important. And that's when I got, I think, off the track, because I mentioned this hard edge thing that came about. Because in order to get out of the Children's Society series, not to get out of it, but what had happened with the Children's Society series was that the competition line across there started to bend, and it became a parabola shape. And it really became a parabola shape to the point where this figure, or the figures were reduced to one or two figures inside that parabola shape, as though they were in a phallic symbol, as though it was a phallic symbol. Mm-hmm. And everything around it was precisely done, hard-edged stuff, little symbols here and there. Mm-hmm. And I knew that that was not quite me. I wanted to be able to get the mark making so that the energy flow that I had earlier on could reassert itself. So that was one of my goals when I had an opportunity for a leave. And we went to Mexico. That was an interesting experience too, because my goal was to take this leave. It was a 4-month period of time. And I was going to go to New York, set up a studio and work in New York and make contacts and all kinds of things. And so I went to New York on a kind of reconnaissance trip to check it out. And I got there and I looked around and talked to some people and did some things and came to the realization that I could not, in good conscience, bring my wife and 3 kids to New York while I went out and did this other stuff. It would be financially awkward, but more so than that, it would be psychologically depressing, and I don't know exactly how to put it, but it just didn't seem to me that it was going to be a good mix to bring all that together. So I came back from New York dejected, knowing that this was not going to work well. And I didn't know exactly what I was going to do. And my wife miraculously said, let's go to Mexico. Where did that come from? What does Mexico have to do with anything? And the more I thought about it, the more it made a little sense. So we decided to go to Mexico, which we did for 4 months. And survived that experience. It was a wonderful experience. We spent 4 months in Guadalajara. Dana and Larry went to the American School of Guadalajara. And Kara was home with her mom, and I was out doing artwork. Walking the streets, doing drawings, paintings, coming back and working, and had enough space in the house to do some work. And Kara's first birthday was in Mexico. Her first words were Spanish. It was a wonderful experience. But what came out of that experience from the standpoint of my artwork was I worked my way out of that hard edge thing. I got back into the business of scratching and digging and so forth, into the work. It was as though, as my former department chair in California said, you don't know if the paper's going to come out alive or not when he starts working on it. Mm-hmm. And it was a good feeling to get back into digging and scratching, and the physical aspect of doing the work was cool, as opposed to the intellectualizing of everything. And having experience walking around in Guadalajara, I became more alert to and aware of the people in the area, what they were wearing, what their situation seemed to be. I encountered more people who were homeless, who were begging on the street, or who were just down and out on their luck than I had focused on in the past, although those people those kind of situations that exist all over the world, it became very apparent to me while I was in Guadalajara. And I think it was amplified by the fact that so many people wore black. You know, kind of scarves and dress and so forth with black. So this business of an impending doom seemed to override everything. So a lot of the work that I was doing back in those days was scratching and digging, but they had skeletal forms that came into being, figures shrouded in these dark clothing and so forth. And some of that's still floating around, but it's changed. Now, all of that went on for quite a while, and then much like the Microscape series and the Children's Society series, another series came about back in the early 70s. This series was called the Truck Series. It was like driving down the street, and instead of looking in your side of the mirror, you're looking ahead, and there's this huge semi-truck in front of you, and you stop behind it, and the truck is so large it fills your entire vision. Mm-hmm. You know, and you become very much aware of the fact that this truck is a barrier. You can't get through this truck. You could go around it, or if you had an opportunity, you could open the doors and see inside the truck, but there's a frontal barrier. There's a space that says, this is it. You can't go any further than this. But intellectually, you know there's space inside, there's space around it. So you get, again, you got this interior-exterior space. So what I encountered, or what I accepted as a challenge, was how to present this frontality, this frontal barrier, at the same time transcend it, so that there's an opportunity to deal with space beyond that. So the first few drawings and paintings in the series were backs of trucks. They were representational enough that you knew it was the back of the truck, and numbers and insignias and lights and so forth. But there was a little edge to the truck that looked beyond it, kind of like looking at a Jules Zelinski painting, where the edge of the painting had a brighter color than something else, you know? Mm-hmm. And so I was using those edges to show that sense of distance. At the same time, I was creating transparent images on the surface of the truck to suggest that there was a link with mankind. So figurative elements were emerging out of the surface of the truck. And just as words were coming into being, into focus, like, wash me, I'm a dirty truck, you know, things that people do to trucks and so forth. So this truck series went on for a while, and and around the same time I was doing what I call the remnant series. The remnant series is a little bit more abstract. I would pick up little bits and pieces of things on the street or out of magazines or wherever, and those things would get laminated into the surface with paint and so forth. So it was a combination of acrylic paint and collage materials and found objects and so on. But I started wondering what these found objects, what all this meant and where it was coming from, and came to the conclusion that some of it had to relate to my childhood growing up in New York. So in 1982, I made a concerted effort to go back to New York and kind of go through some of the places that I had been as a kid. So walking around the streets of New York, in Harlem, where I grew up, and seeing buildings and seeing graffiti on the buildings and seeing words that are and notices put on buildings to say this is a condemned building, this building is off limits, so this is, you know, all of these official signs on the building combined with the graffiti marks on the building and the building surface itself created this sense of the building is a surface that somehow has attracted the attention of mankind, so that there's an interaction between human and structure. And so the truck series immediately transformed, got transferred into the idea of a wall series. And this photograph that I pointed out to you earlier was a photo that was taken on 145th Street in the storefront down the street from where I used to live. And it was the piece that 10 years later I was inspired, this painting that's next to it. And the idea of that dark and light area was a carryover from my interest in dark and light, so that when you squint at that and you look at the dark area, it sinks in, and the light area becomes kind of an upside down U that houses the dark space. And so anyway, when I came back from New York on that 82 trip, the one change that was evident in the Remnant series was the introduction of bricks, which made it the wall series in reality, because the wall now had bricks and you couldn't be mistaken for some abstracted space with little things floating around in it. Mm-hmm. So all the things that went on that space had references to torn paper, posters peeling, paint peeling, graffiti marks, things scratched into the surface and so forth. So the wall series went on like that for some time. And became kind of intriguing from the standpoint that some of the selection of some of the things that went on the wall appeared as so they were in opposition with something else. So you might have in one section, for example, something that took place in 1930 in contrast to something that was happening today. Or you might have a situation that was political in one sense next to something that was very sexual in another sense, or something that was humorous next to something that was horrific in another sense. So those kind of sense of opposites inside the communicative elements became a part of it. And the other thing that became a part of the wall series was the introduction of figure development, because going back to the time when I was doing figures, those figures had kind of a spiritual attitude or notion to it, and as well as a kind of transformative aspect, because they were linked into the landscape, and the relationship between the landscape and the figure created some sense of some kind of aura. And anyway, the figure that came back into the wall series was a shadow. It's a shadow of a figure on the margin of the end of life. They were either old, infirm, homeless, whatever. There's something that was less than wholesome about this shadow walking past. On one hand, well, they could have been wholesome too. In some cases they were. But the shadow is seemingly detached from the wall because it's just passing by. So the wall doesn't exist. And in many instances, when we see marginal people in an urban environment, we don't really see them. We just know that they exist. And we walk past them just as the shadow walks past the wall. Mm-hmm. So the shadow became part of this wall series element as indicated here. In most cases, the figure that's passing the wall is carrying something, a bag, or they have a cane in their hand or some other stick that they're using to assist them in walking. Sometimes the bag that they're carrying in their hand starts to look like a head, and so the person is out hunting heads and bringing them back home. There's all sorts of strange little elements that show up in there. This particular piece is a doorway, and the doorway is chained off, as noticed into here. So even if you wanted to go in that door, you couldn't. And there's all sorts of elements in there. And the kinds of things that I was using on the surface range from acrylic paint to spray paint to posters literally peeled off walls and reapplied to the surface, stucco mix, Liquitex texture gel, and almost any variety of material. This one even has metal and some rust, synthetic rust. The synthetic rust is a two-part process where you put this liquid iron on and come back 12 hours later and paint the rust solution on and changes to rust. You know that stuff, you like that, don't you?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I kind of stopped using it. Temporarily, I still have some. Not too long ago, I came to realize that some of the people who see my work would stand there and read all of the information that was in the posters and the newspaper clippings that I had put in there. And they were trying to draw relationships between what was written on that on those posters with something else. And I'm saying to myself, you're missing the point. This is not what this is about. It's not about those individual little things. So I need to do something about that. So my notion was to reduce the amount of information. Let that information take on another attitude of being a remnant. Mm-hmm. So I started tearing into it more, leaving only not a whole word, but a letter or two, and reducing the number of these kinds of things in the space and putting more emphasis on texture and color. It's not so much evident in this, because this is before that happened. But, and then that ultimately led me to thinking more about this business of the space again. Because with the wall series, the wall took the place of the truck being the front of the barrier. With the idea that you could open the door and go into the space, or you could look through a window, you could somehow get into it. Mm-hmm. But from a metaphorical point of view, the idea of having two or more spaces also suggests that there are two or more kinds of environments, there are two or more kinds of worlds, there's a life and a death, there's, you know, these those kind of opposites come back into focus again, so that some of the newer pieces have gone back into history. There was a piece that was in the MOCA GA exhibit called Amazing Grace, Through Time. And that one had slave shackles suspended in the middle, which takes you all the way back to days of slavery. And the semblance of a slave ship with bodies impacted in the lower section. But from a design point of view, it was effective from my perspective because it created a sense of depth as well as distance in time. So the idea of the wall being a barrier is no longer a primary thing in my work. From my perspective, what is there now is that the surface can be a barrier, but the surface can also be a membrane. The surface can be an element that allows you to move from one level to another level. It allows you to think in terms of distance, think in terms of time. It allows you to bring your own notions into the work. Somebody asked me once about what was my work trying to say? What's the story behind the work? And I don't really have a story behind the work. I think each piece, while I work in series, you could say that there's kind of a thematic link to all of those things. There's no specific story behind each one, unless there's something that you brought to it that brings that story to life. From my perspective, when I'm working on something, I'm more concerned about the organizational unity within the work, how these areas come together to create a sense of self, how darks and lights work together, how lines work in conjunction with that, how colors and textures work in conjunction with that, so that when you orchestrate it and put it all together, these things are saying, I am. I have a sense of self. I have a sense of who I am. And I present myself to you, and you can take it or leave it. But in most cases, if I present myself to you well, you're going to respond, because you can't walk past me and say, I don't exist. You may not like me. You may find reasons to dislike me, or you may love me, but you cannot walk past me and say, I don't exist. So from my perspective, if the work does that, then I've succeeded in terms of saying something in the work itself that's an extension of me It's an extension of some of my process. So that it is part of me. And I can walk away from it and be satisfied that it's complete. But when you come to it, the viewer, you may walk up and say, did I see painting there? Hey, what was that? And they go back and look at it again. If the painting has done something to you, if there's been a connection, then whatever that connection is may extend all the way back to your childhood and something that affected you when you were young and you thought about your experience you had with a Stanley or you had with a, you know, a class here or something you had when you were walking along this desert, whatever, you know. If something connected with you and you can relate to that, that's fine. Now, in some of the more, I'll tell you about an experience I had. When I retired from Georgia State University, there was a, among other things, with the exhibit and so forth, there was a little book that was generated by some of the faculty members or the gallery director that allowed people to put little comments in the book about their relationship with me or my work or whatever. And one professor wrote a comment in the book that just floored me. He said that he'd gone to see one of my exhibits, and it was during the time when I was doing these figurative statements where figures out in the landscape all by itself. It's kind of alone. It was kind of a lonely aloneness in the work. And he said, when he saw those pieces, he thought about his relationship to his father. And his father was a cantankerous old man. He was up in age, he was couldn't do for himself so much, so they put him in a nursing home. And he came to see the exhibit, he started thinking about his dad being alone in that kind of environment. And he said, the next few days, he went to the nursing home and got his dad out, took him home. He said he was still a cantankerous old man, but it sure made me feel better to know that he was with family and not out there on his own. And I thought that that was such a moving experience on one hand, that if my work had anything to do with that, it only had something, only a little part to do with that. Most of it was him, the man himself, and how he reacted to the work. That made it significant. My daughter, my youngest daughter, Kara, said something to me once. She says, your work makes me feel, it makes me, some of the work makes me want to cry. She says, it has such an impact, such a power, that it generates feelings and attitudes from the viewer. She says, I sure hope that at some point my work will be able to command that kind of attention. Anyway, that's it's not my intent to make people cry. It's not my intent to make people have bad reactions. But it is my intent that work will be alive. Will take on a sense of self that says, I am.
Larry, thank you for that amazing story of your life. Going to be really important to scholars years to come to be able to hear you in your own words talk about your journey, talk about the beginning, and talk about where it has taken you today. And we just look forward to what is to come in the future. I would also like to have you talk a little bit about winning the Working Artist Project Award that
was funded by the Charles Lawrence Foundation for the museum, for MOCA GA. I know that you had an incredible experience with the studio assistants. You mentored them. You took it so seriously, and you affected the lives of two young emerging artists. Could you talk a little bit about what it meant to win that award, how it may have helped you, about the year, the work that you did, and the studio assistants that accompanied you?
Sure. In fact, winning the award was a wonderful experience. I thought back earlier, I made a comment about the time that my partner and I in California had completed this work for the California Arts Council, and had a professor of mathematics say to us that this was the equivalent of a PhD, and that was a unique experience then, because it represented the kind of peak in one's career, winning this Working Artist Project Award at my vast age was an incredible experience, because when you reach a certain age, you expect not to win things. You expect to be tapering off. Here I am, retired from 42 years of teaching and doing some hard work, and perhaps more than I did before, but still working. They had this Working Artist Project pop up as an award winner after X number of people had applied for and been looked at, and some very good people had been looked at for the award. I felt really, really good about being the recipient of the award. For me, it kind of validated a career. It kind of said to me and to some other people perhaps that what you've done has some significance, it has some meaning for others, and it's important enough to support your efforts in continuing. And in the process of winning that award, several things were very important, one of which, and the most important, I think, was the link with the studio assistants. And the museum allowed me to use two studio assistants, as long as I stayed within the same framework of financial framework, and that was really wonderful, because I was able to select Michael Schofield, who has an MFA in painting from Georgia State University, and I had known him from a previous class that he took with me before I retired, and Yannick Norman, who was a young artist in town who has actually never taken an art class. And to have both of them come together and work in the studio, sometimes together, sometimes individually, was a unique experience for me. It gave me an opportunity to get back into a teaching mode, so to speak. I mean, I enjoyed teaching. I loved every moment of working with students. Sometimes it was frustrating, sure, but for the most part, if you're talking to people about what it is that they want to do and you're trying to find ways to help them get there, that was always a unique experience. I found that reoccurring with the studio assistants. Not only were they able to listen to what kinds of things I needed from them, I listened to what kinds of things they needed from me. And I hopefully provided some things that were meaningful to them, and I know they provided a lot that was meaningful to me. Not only in terms of the physical things that they did, but some of the discussions we had about life, the discussions we had about art, the discussions we had about political issues and how that related to art and life. Those are all meaningful things, and it seemed to be important and unique for them. I know one of the things that they both helped me with was pulling together some of the paperwork on my past experiences. We didn't quite get that all finished, but we got a lot of it done. And it's kind of a documentation of paperwork that goes back to, it goes back to about 1980 something. So I still have a few years to go back, but to get some of that out of the way was wonderful. But more so than that, the opportunity of working with me on a piece, a painting, I think was unique because they made a lot of discoveries about materials and what materials could do, what kinds of things you need to do to certain materials to make sure that they were archivally appropriate to the work. And Michael, for example, has been using a lot of different materials in his work. And he was using a lot before, but now he's using them in a slightly different way. They're more secure, they're more able to hang with the painting for a long period of time. And unique, while she was previously focused only on graphite pencil, she did gravitate out a little bit and she's started using a little watercolor, she started using a little charcoal, she started using a couple of materials, and more than anything, she started using the space in a different way. After our discussions about planes and shadows that come off figures and how they fall onto the plane and so forth, she started using some of those. But I'm still in touch with both of them, and I enjoyed working with them a great deal, and they encouraged me to do some of the things that I was toying with anyway. I was, in my work, I had started drawing or pulling out little images that I ultimately call wall spirits or spirit voices. And these were images that were already in the work, but I could embellish them a little bit and articulate a little better what those things were. And they started to see them as well and started to encourage me to bring out more of them. I thought that was also a unique experience. But if there was an opportunity to win another Working Artist Award, I would be right there. At any rate, I think that all of the artists who have received that award and subsequently have done well in terms of utilizing the space, space and time to get work done, and also in terms of the exhibition that came as a result of all of the work. I've been very impressed with the exhibitions that I've seen from each one of the artists who participated in the Working Artist Project. And I certainly hope that the museum is able to continue that process and beyond this coming year into the years ahead. It's not every museum in every community that has an opportunity to do something that's directly influencing artists who live in that same community. And I think that's one of the marvelous things about it. And I have to applaud the Laurentian Foundations for recognizing that this was a contribution that they could help the museum make. And I think all of the artists in the community appreciate it a great deal.
Thank you, Larry. The Working Artist Project is a legacy initiative of the museum. I hope I have every intention while I'm there that it continues, and it has been such a strong, strong program and received with open arms and so welcomed by the art community that I think it's taking on a life of its own. You were our very first recipient. It was the inaugural exhibition, an incredible body of work that you put together, Larry. I feel, and I hope you do, that it was one of your finest exhibitions and a highlight in your career. Mm-hmm. I really thank you for taking the opportunity in the year and giving it 100% all of your energy, all of your knowledge, all of your intelligence and your talent. It was a beautiful show. Thank you.
Thank you.
Did you want to? include anything else that you had from before?
No.
Okay.
I did.
Yeah, he did.
It was the wall spirits.
Okay. Yeah. All right.
All right. This is a good one.